Well, good morning, Jeremiah. How are you?
I am doing pretty good. And you?
Well, I'm exhausted, and I'll tell you why. I just finished a two-week road trip. Last night I got home at like 2 in the morning.
Wow.
Yeah, yesterday was my last long stretch. I came all the way from Denver in one day. 16 hours, child.
Yeah, and Denver is, what, 8 hours from me. And so if you're in California, I'm assuming?
L.A., yeah.
L.A., yeah, so, yeah.
Oh, well, no, where are you? Where am I talking to you?
I'm in Provo, Utah.
Oh, Provo, oh, okay. I'm going to be up there soon for FantasyCon.
Oh, you're coming up to FantasyCon.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
July, what's July?
3rd through 5th?
3, 4, 5, right, yeah.
Yeah, you should also come up to Salt Lake Comic Con. It's pretty big.
Well, I should, if they would invite me. You know what I mean?
Well, I'll send them some more requests.
Yeah,
they send us surveys every once in a while to see who we want there. And
there you go. There you go.
I'm only allowed to send like 3 at a time, which is always hard to pick 3 people.
Well, you're going
to
pick me next time, Jeremiah. Do you hear me?
Yes, I do.
Thank you.
So I guess we'll just start there. You were doing a two-week road trip, like a speaking tour or like a performance tour? Or
no, I normally wouldn't do that by car. I do have like quite a tour this summer of fan conventions. In fact, FantasyCon in July is going to be one of 10 that I'm doing this year, during my Falling Skies hiatus. So there happened to be a week on either side of my Knoxville, Tennessee Fanboy Expo that I just did a week ago, last weekend. A week and some days ago. So I saw on the map, like, oh, okay, if I rent an SUV, I can drive all the way to Knoxville, do the convention, then go up to my hometown of Indianapolis, Indiana, from there quickly, and gather up the rest of the stuff from my mom's house after she passed away a year ago, fill that SUV, and then drive it all the way back to L.A. So that's why it took me 2 weeks.
Ah, okay, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I've done quite a few of those long drives, and you get really exhausted by the end, especially if you like really push the last day to get home.
Because I took my time getting back. I lollygagged my way to Denver, which is only halfway. So it was like, so in one day I was like, I got to get home. I got an interview at 10 a.m. with Jeremiah Bombad Radio.
Well, thank you for getting back. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Usually most people would just be like, well, we'll do it some other time. Give us a month or two when we let you relax.
Like, I could have done it from a hotel on the road, too. But I also have, like, I have a table read and costume fitting today for a web series I'm about to start called Nobility. It's sort of like Star Trek meets The Office.
So what's that type of camera style? So basically a documentary style sci-fi series.
Sort of mockumentary sci-fi series, right, with a tongue-in-cheek humor about itself, yes.
Wow, that sounds like a lot of fun.
Could be fun. I'm going to be the ship's counselor, sort of like the psychologist on board, and I'm a bit too handsy, which is very me.
Are you going to be in prosthetics for that, or is it you're going to be prosthetic free?
Prosthetic free. It'll just be me with my own face. Yeah, when it comes to web series and things that are lower budget like that, the thing that will attract me to the piece is if I can do it with my own face.
Okay. But most of your projects, you seem to be doing lots and lots of prosthetics.
I would say a good half now. It used to be most, like it used to be 90%. And I've been doing a lot more with my own face lately. Not this year, but last season one of The Neighbors on ABC, I was in 6 episodes as one of the goofy alien neighbors posing as a human. And I had so much fun with that. I also guest starred on Sons of Anarchy last year with my Hellboy co-star, Ron Perlman. It was a guest cameo that was like, well, let's just say this. It was not the Hellboy reunion you would have wanted. He was in prison. Ron Perlman's character was in prison last season before they killed him off, and and I was one of the prison guards. And there was a very unsavory conjugal visit lined up with Katie Sagal and that a prison guard partner of mine and I were also involved with. I shouldn't go on from there, honestly. And then last year I also guest starred on an episode of Teen Wolf. I played a very colorful and evil villain named William Barrow, who loves to kill kids with glowing red eyes, which is most of the cast of Teen Wolf.
Yeah. And we had Gideon Emery on, who's one of the major villains in that show, mm-hmm. and that's how he described it.
There you go. Yeah, and, you know, when you're asked to be on a show like Teen Wolf, you look at yourself in the mirror and you say, okay, something's amiss here, because I've seen Teen Wolf, and it's a bunch of pretty young people. I'm not sure what they want with a 54-year-old scrawny guy. I found out it's to be an evil fella. But you still do have to take your shirt off. I think that's a rule for being on that show. You have to take your shirt off.
It's like if you're on the CW, even Arrow, your shirt has to come off sometime or another.
I'm right. Right? Why have television without shirtless shows, right?
Exactly, especially on MTV and CW.
Right.
So you have a very unique set of talents and background. I think the only other person with your set of talents we've had on is Bill Blair, who I think he has a record for a number of like prosthetics worn in TV shows and movies and so on. He has like the Guinness Book of World Records. So I guess we're going to start off at the very beginning. As I recall reading, you started off as a mime, didn't you? And then when you got into college, you became like a school mascot because you were so good at miming.
Look, I don't think I didn't become the school mascot because I was so good at anything, really. But yes, I did start as a mime with a mime troupe called Mime Over Matter. See, it's a funny little pun. And I did that for my freshman through senior years at Ball State, developing that mime skill, which I didn't realize how handy that would come in later. And then the mascot was just something I wanted to do because I went to the basketball and football games and saw there's more that can be done with that big bird suit. Because you always think you can do better. That's typical heart and soul of an actor is I could have done that better. So I auditioned for that. I ended up being the basketball Charlie Cardinal at Ball State University for my junior and senior years.
And that was one of those mascots where you're not allowed to tell anyone who's actually in the suit until you're not in the suit anymore.
Oh no, I did. I thought, you know what? If I'm gonna be putting my heart and soul and sweat into this, people are gonna know about it. Dagnabbit. So, no, I've always been a press junkie. I was in the school newspaper and the school magazine many a time. One cover article they did was on the school magazine was me in a mime makeup, holding my Charlie Cardinal head mascot, hold the head next to me with the beak going in my ear and my enemy having a oh face. It was quite cute. It was cute.
So we have a few questions from our listeners, mostly about Guillermo del Toro stuff, because
he's my favorite director I've ever worked with, and every other director knows that going in, so there's no competition. There's love.
But before we get to Guillermo del Toro, we're going to start with some of your earlier stuff, because you're known as a contortionist. Mm-hmm. You're known as someone who can make your body do very strange things. But a lot of your early roles, as I recall, like Batman Returns and I think Hocus Pocus, you started off with more acrobatics. What was your original intention when you got into Hollywood? What did you want to be when you first got in?
Not what I'm doing today. My career as it developed has become a bit of a surprise to me. My original intention was to be a sitcom star, or because I grew up on funny half-hour shows, and those were my escape. Those were my inspiration to that it's okay to be a tall, skinny, goofy guy, watching characters like Gomer Pyle and Gilligan and Barney Fife and anything Dick Van Dyke did or Jerry Lewis movies. Oh my gosh, Danny Kaye. And then when I discovered variety shows like the Carol Burnett show with all that cast of tomfoolery and any other variety show at the time, Sonny and Cher, Donnie Marie, everybody had a variety show back in the 60s, 70s. So growing up watching funny skits, funny half-hour stories where everyone's hugging at the end, That was a way for a tall, skinny, goofy kid in Indiana to find solace and escape from, you know, the taunting and the making fun of that happens at school, which I combated by developing a sense of humor. And I got that sense of humor from those TV shows. So when I went out to Hollywood, it was with the intention of being one of those people one day to hopefully inspire and offer another goofy kid back in the Midwest some escape one day. But the contortionist thing, I'm kind of a one pony trick with that. I can put my legs behind my head if I lean forward, and that's about it. But that goes on my resume as contortionist. So it's shocking how many roles I got early in the day, especially because of that special skill being there. And between that and the miming on my resume, having some body awareness and having developed that art form where you can communicate without verbal dialogue or with it. We use our bodies all day anyway when we're communicating, and about half of the message we're giving is verbal and the other half would be visual. So I learned a lot about that from those early skills from college, and not knowing that when I got to Hollywood, I would be sort of like a blank canvas that was desirable for people in the creature effects industry. When a creature effects designer sees a tall, skinny guy with some awareness of his movement walk into a room, they're like, oh my gosh, look at that tiny bone structure, but look at the length. Oh my gosh. You know, it's just like, that's a dreamland to build on. So I'm told by all the people in that business. And so that's kind of how it started, was being the right template. And then the performance that comes with it is what gets you the referral for the next thing. Well, that and being nice. And most actors have a reputation for being prima donnas and self-absorbed and narcissists, and rightfully so. We're all full of ourselves. But when you don't complain about the makeup you've said yes to, and when you just go ahead and wear the heavy costume and push through it to make a performance happen, the creature effects people really remember that part. If you were kind and gentle to work with, because most actors aren't, I guess. And I didn't know that coming from Indiana. I thought, well, when you say yes to a job, you said yes to a job, so you just do it, don't you? I mean, I don't understand why that's an exception. Why you're being nice? That's crazy. So it kind of took me by surprise.
So one of the first big movies, actually might be the first like big movie you were in, was Batman Returns, a sequel to probably the most successful film from the 80s. Yeah. What was your first reaction when you got cast in such a huge Tim Burton sequel?
Right.
You were in Batman.
Right. Well, I had done a couple of schlocky horror films before that, but nothing with a big wide release and nothing with that kind of stature. So my first big studio release movie was indeed Batman Returns. And I got in the door for that through the stunt department. Actually, I have a stuntman friend named Bob Yerkes. He's a legend. He comes up through the circus, and he's in his 80s now, but still working. He's like tough as nails, this man. Anyway, so back in the early 90s when they were casting the Batman movie, he was helping the stunt department. He's helping the stunt coordinator of Batman Returns because there was a circus theme to it. The Red Triangle Circus Gang was very prevalent in the movie, and that's where the Penguin, played by Danny DeVito, hung out. So they were casting up all of the circus acts that would comprise the Red Triangle Circus Gang. Well, I didn't know how big of a deal that was going to be when I got a phone call from the stunt department saying, hey, a friend of yours, Bob Yerkes, refers to you. You're a contortionist. So, you know, we might need, you know, I was just thinking it was going to be a sight gag for a day or two of work and I could be done with it. So I went into the Warner Brothers lot one day to meet with the stunt coordinator, showed him my whole repertoire of bendy bits. You know, it was short. That was a very short performance. You know, hey, here's what I can do. Yada, yada, yada. Wonka, wonka, wonka. And then he said, wow, okay, let me go. You stay right here and I'm going to get somebody. He walked back into the room with Tim freaking Burton, right? So here I am, this young actor going, what? So once I wiped up the drool, I said hello. And so the stunt coordinator said, well, show Tim what you just showed me. Yada, 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 wada, 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 da, 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 da. So Tim was like, wow, that's okay. Hey, well, we're going to go into the next room and talk about you for a minute. So the two of them left me in this office on the Warner Brothers lot. And I was the longest minute and a half of my life. They come back in and Tim says, great, you got the job. And I thought, well, no, you got the part, he said. And I thought, wait, I thought I was just here for a sight gag. There's a part. And it turns out that I played Thin Clown in the movie, which was part of the Red Triangle Circus gang that hung out with Danny DeVito all the time. And I ended up being in about six scenes in the movie, and I was contracted for 7 weeks, and it was extended all the way to 14 weeks by the time it was done. So it turned into a big job for me at the time. I was working at scale, but it was like, oh my gosh, 14 weeks of employment as an actor. It's like, no. And when the movie came out in theaters, it was the largest box office opening weekend in history at that time in 1992. So there was love. There was love. Insta love.
Well, what are some of the things that you learned from working with Tim Burton and, you know, Danny DeVito was there, Michael Keaton, working on such a big movie? I'm quite sure you came away from with it with a lot of lessons learned and probably things you wish you could have improved on.
Well, sure. Now, being that I was a very much a supporting player, and I had one line of dialogue in the entire film. Now, originally there was a scene where I had a back and forth dialogue for about a page. That was rewritten into one line, but being present with all these people, I had less responsibility than the big stars of the movie, for sure. And what I learned from that was, I think, the on-set etiquette of, because when you don't have to have a whole lot of, when you don't have a heavy scene with lots of dialogue and lots of emotion to portray that day, you just have a couple of moments where you're supposed to look weird and put your leg behind your head and run at Batman with a bomb strapped to your chest and get beaten back, so you have to learn a little stunt thing. You have time on set when you're doing that to play around a lot, joke with people, tell stories, yap, 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 yap. When you're working with a huge star who has a lot to concentrate on that day, they're not quite in such a yappy mood. So I did learn that to give people their space when they need to concentrate. And now that I'm doing, have been doing bigger roles myself for, many, many years now, I can appreciate the space needed for that. And so I learned how to take that time for yourself when you have a big responsibility that day, and not be ungracious to those who want to yap with you, but to clear enough headspace to prepare for what's going to go on film, because you don't want to take all of your tomfoolery onto the camera with you and not be prepared for the scene. So I learned a little bit acting lesson there, I guess.
So we have one fan question that comes before we start talking about Del Toro, and one of the most bizarre movies I remember seeing in the 90s was Warriors of Virtue,
yeah,
with Kung Fu Kangaroos, and it was a very strange movie. So he wants to know, were you aware of what this movie was before you went in there, and what did you think of being on a movie that was really that bizarre, and was it even more bizarre filming it, since you don't know what the whole thing together is when you're filming it in pieces?
Right. Well, yeah, Warriors of Virtue, I had no idea what I was getting into. I kind of like... It was the creature effects designer, Tony Gardner at Alterian Studios, that referred me for that job, because they had to cast the five kangaroo kung fu fighting warriors of virtue. And one of them was the biggest one, the tallest, broadest shouldered one, was Yi. And he was completely silent and talked in sign language that he made up himself, which I had to do. And I was not the broadest shouldered one, but they padded me out to the... I was ginormous, a big lumbering, like, strong character in that, which is the antithesis of who I am in real life, being as skinny as I am. But I went into it knowing it was a fantasy film geared toward, 8 to 12 year old boys. So there's going to be a lot of action, but I didn't know the artistic direction it was going to take. And then I saw a script later. After saying yes to the job, I got a script and read the story and was like, oh, I get it. But, this little boy goes off into a fantasy land and becomes a bit of a hero himself and learns these virtues. Every warrior of virtue represented a different virtue and a different value. So there was loyalty and there was truth and honor and whatever. And I was righteousness. And And all of us also represented an element of nature. There was water and wood and fire and I was metal. So all of us with our fighting style and our weapons reflected our virtue and our element of nature. So it was very ethereal and lesson learning for kids to watch. And the action was extremely that Hong Kong style of you know fight film. But geared for kids, so it was kept clean, but it was very, very choreographed and very acrobatic. So we had stunt doubles. All of us Warriors of Virtue were Americans that were cast, but we filmed this movie in Beijing, China for 4 months. So that was the experience that I remember most was, oh my gosh, I'm in. And when you go to China in 1996, you are not leaving your country, you're leaving Earth. You know, when you're an American, it felt like that. Like, where am I? Because, you know, as a tall, skinny, blonde, round, blue-eyed guy, I was a freak of nature there. And every time I left the hotel, the people on the streets thought the circus had come to town. I got my picture taken. They wanted to touch my hair. It was great fun for 2 weeks. And then the rest of the 4 months, I was like, I can't go outside. So that was great. Ronnie Yu, our director, was very creative with his direction. And so I think, you know, it wasn't the biggest hit in the box office, but it had an artistic flair to it that was unlike any other kids film I'd ever done. And so the storyline might have been a little bit hard to follow because of the editing style, but it was very, with a second view, you could understand more. So I didn't hate the experience at all. And it did, it was a cultural thing for me, the filming of it. And I learned a lot about choreography and physical presence from that, because I had to channel something that I really, really wasn't. And we had stunt doubles that were from Hong Kong that were like half my height. So that was a trick, you know, getting me starting an action move and the stunt guy going crazy, like flips and tumbles and kicks and things in the air and spinning rings around his arms. And you know, I had metal rings that were my weapon. Oh, my word. It was just intense. And then I would come and do the last pose. You know, at the end of it, like I did that whole thing. So I had the easy job, to be honest with you.
But now we're going to move into Guillermo del Toro, because that same year Warriors of Virtue came out, you were in Mimic, mm-hmm. which I believe is the first Guillermo del Toro movie you were involved in. So working on Mimic in 97, mm-hmm. before going to Hellboy in 2004, did you have any connection with del Toro in the meantime? Did you have any relationship with him in Mimic that led to Hellboy later on? How did that happen?
I had no relationship with him before Mimic. That's where I met him for the first time, and that's where the relationship began. But there was a bit of a gap after that. We met on Mimic in 1997. Weeks before the film came out in theaters, they were doing some reshoots here in Los Angeles. I was not involved in principal photography, which took place up in Toronto, in Canada. The tall, skinny guy who did the Long John characters on film, that was the bugs that looked sort of mimicked humans. He was Canadian. And when it came time to do like some last minute, oh, we need this shot and that shot to complete the movie, that's when the phone calls went around. Like, what tall, skinny guy do we know that we can work with? Ah! So I got a phone call like late one afternoon. Are you free for a night shoot tonight? And so my answer was, yeah, I am. That's when I donned the bug suit, the tall, mimicky, man-like bug suit, and worked for 3 days on Mimic. And it was day two that I finally met the director of this movie, and that was Guillermo del Toro. He sat down across the lunch table from me at our lunch break and just said, so tell me every movie you've been in before. That was quite a tall question. So I started telling him, you know, other projects I'd done, other creatures I'd played at that point. And that included Hocus Pocus with Bette Midler as the goofy zombie guy. And this is 1997. So I had done Warriors of Virtue as well by then. And I had done Batman Returns. I told him about all that. And Tank Girl. I had done Tank Girl. So I'd worked with Stan Winston. I'd worked with Tony Gardner at Alterian. I had also met that's right. I'd done a couple things for Greg Canham, another Oscar-winning makeup artist. So it was the makeup artist that really struck his fancy. Guillermo del Toro was like, oh, is that Tony Gardner? What was he like as a person? Was he a nice guy? And so I would tell him, sure, yeah. And he'd be like, oh, yeah. So by the end of our conversation, I was realizing that this is an 8-year-old boy wrapped in the roly-poly, grown-up man suit. And he just loved creepy, crawly things and monsters and movies and eating popcorn and getting excited. And that's what makes – I realized in an instant that this man is special and different than any other director I'd ever met. And but this was his first American studio film, so I wasn't aware of who he was before that lunch date, before when he sat down. So before he gets up from lunch, he says, do you have a card? So I dug a card out of my bag and said, yeah, this is me. It was a goofy drawing of myself with a phone number coming out of my mouth. And he goes, oh, that's great. And he put it in his wallet. Then I went on to do more work in the next 5 years, including the Rocky and Bullwinkle movie with Robert De Niro and Piper Perabo and Jason Alexander and Rene Russo. And then I did Monkey Bone with Brendan Fraser and Buffy the Vampire Slayer, my Hush episode that turned out to be a fan phenomenon over the years. So that show never dies, and the fan base for anything Whedon, Joss Whedon, is so loyal and wonderful.
And Rick Baker too with Men in Black too.
And Rick Baker with Men in Black too had happened before then too, right? So, good call. So I had done some more things, and then all of a sudden I get this phone call again from Steve Wang in 2000. It was at the end of 2002 actually, when they were doing some prep work for the first Hellboy movie. And Steve Wang calls me from the Creature Shop and says, "Hey, Doug. We're working on this movie. Do you want to come in tomorrow to meet with us for this particular character we have in mind for you?" And I said, sure. And he said, yeah. And the director says he knows you. And so that director happened to be Guillermo del Toro. So what happened was that day earlier, before I got the phone call, they had done the maquette for the Abe Sapien character for Hellboy. The sculpture was finished, and they were presenting it to Guillermo del Toro for his final approval. And legend has it that he walked into the room, they unveiled this beautiful sculpture, and he fell to his knees and said, "Oh, I am so fat," which I think was his way of saying, what a beautiful thin creature this is. So that's when the sculptor, Jose Fernandez, and the Creature Shop owner, Mike Elizalde, and Steve Wang, the designer of all this, this creature. All three of them had worked with me before and said, you know, who should really play this character is Doug Jones. And so Guillermo said, Doug Jones. Wait, I know Doug Jones. And he pulled my card out of his wallet that I gave him 5 years before that on the Mimic set. So that's when I got the call. And so that became me as Abe Sapien in the first Hellboy movie that led to a much more solidified relationship with Guillermo del Toro. We really learned a shorthand between actor and director, and, you know, he can say nothing to me and I'll know what he wants, or he'll say a lot to me and before we start filming, and so I know what to do when I get on set. He's just a brilliant gem to work with. He knows all of his actors better than we know ourselves. He knows our strengths and our shortcomings, and he plays with those, and he knows what set of buttons he can push to get a reaction out of us. And he directs every actor very differently. I noticed that between Hellboy 1 and 2. When I came back to the set for Hellboy 2, my role of Abe Sapien was even bigger. He had me throughout the entire film. And so I spent a lot more on-camera time with Ron Perlman and Selma Blair, especially, and Jeffrey Tambor. So watching him direct each one of us with a different tone of voice, a different request set, different comments and style of comments, because he knew each one of us was very different personality-wise and would respond accordingly to his direction. So that's a brilliant, wonderful director who gets a control panel for each actor like that he can push a button and get something out of quickly. So I just love him. So, but between Hellboy 1 and 2, of course, was the life-changing role for me, roles for me which were the Faun and the Pale Man in Pan's Labyrinth. When he wrote that story, he wrote that with the Faun in mind for me, and also wanted me to play the Pale Man. And he so that came out in 2006, at the end of, so we filmed that in 05, and that was just another glorious experience, because to work on a fantasy movie with heavy makeups on, and that end up being compared with the golden era. You know, when I did press for Pan's Labyrinth, all the journalists wanted to compare me with, you know, legends like Boris Karloff and Lon Chaney and Bela Lugosi, and that was so incredibly humbling for me to have my name mentioned in sentences with those, you know, icons that I grew up watching and just marveling at their work. So that was a real page turner for me. Pan's Labyrinth took me from being a goofy mime / contortionist / you know, movement guy / creature performer suit wearer. And no one ever knew what to call me. After Pan's Labyrinth, they started calling me an actor. And that was what I was trained as, and that's what I've been doing all my life. But finally, to be recognized for it, it was Guillermo del Toro's genius that brought that about, to create roles in such an artistic film for an actor to play. It was because of the opportunity he created for me that was done. So I owe him just so much. And so then after...
Oh, to interject about Pan's Labyrinth, how much Spanish did you know before you started that movie? Because that movie's in Spanish.
It is.
And I imagine a lot of the direction he gave would be in Spanish, because a lot of the crew is Spanish. How much Spanish and English was in that movie for you, and how difficult was it working on essentially a foreign language film with a director that speaks English, but he speaks a lot more Spanish?
Right. Well, that was my first of two times I've done that. Now, I also did a movie in French called Gainsbourg, A Heroic Life, or Gainsbourg, Vie Héroïque. That was all in French. When you're working on a foreign film in a foreign country where the entire crew is of that language and of that country, you don't have to pay attention to anything until you hear English. It's really quite liberating, you know, when I'm being directed, if I hear, you know, someone saying, okay, move to the left, that's when I know it's about me, because I'm the only one who would respond to that. But learning the dialogue is the toughest part. I did have some high school Spanish, 2 years of it, and but it had been, you know, 20 years, 25 years between graduating from high school and then doing Pan's Labyrinth. So it was a lot of that Spanish was gone, but the rules and the vocabulary or the pronunciation and the setup of the language and the sentence structure did start coming back as I studied the script. So I did a translation. I had an English translation of the script and a Spanish translation of the script side by side, so I could break down the sentence structure and figure out what I was saying word for word. I actually learned the language of the script and memorized that. So I did not learn it phonetically. I didn't just put sounds out of my mouth. I wanted to know what I was saying and actually have, you know, meaningful interaction with little Ophelia, played by Ivana Baquero in the movie. So the hardest thing I've ever done, honestly. My brain was at work every day, and in addition to a 5-hour makeup application, including stilts, walking around with huge, heavy horns on my head and just, you know, covered from head to toe in rubber makeup bits and suit bits and Velcro and snaps and buckles and weight and heat. To stay that it took a lot out of me, but yet put so much into me too, you know.
On that set, was Guillermo del Toro already thinking about Hellboy 2 and the script, and was he talking to you about his ideas for it? Because I imagine Hellboy 2 took a bit to write, or was he just totally focusing on Pan's Labyrinth at the time, and then afterward he got the ball rolling?
No, he is the most amazing and focused multitasker I've ever known in my life. He did indeed hint that he had – here's what he does. He doesn't ever share the whole basket of goodies with me. He'll hint that he's got something coming. I think when we were doing Pan's Labyrinth, Hellboy 2 had not been greenlit yet. It'd been talked about and was in the works and in development, but hadn't been fully greenlit as it's going to happen. So it finally got greenlit, in 2006. right before I went to do the to film the Silver Surfer movie. Before I did Fantastic Four: Rise of the Silver Surfer, I was just about to leave to go to Vancouver, and I got a call from Guillermo himself saying, "We got greenlit for Hellboy 2." So yay! So that started that whole process. So before he has a habit of not sharing everything with me ahead of time, because as he put it, I don't want you to get too excited about something, and then if we can't do it, you'll kill yourself. So good thought. Better I stick around. So I didn't hear about it until then when I got. It was during the filming of the Silver Surfer movie. I took a weekend and flew out to New York City. And this is in 06. It was about in, I think, I'm going to say September, October, more like October, November. Maybe. You know, it was the fall of 06. The New York Film Festival was happening. And Pan's Labyrinth was doing its first American screening at the New York Film Festival. It was the closing night film of the fest. So New Line Cinema flew me out there from Vancouver so I could just come and buzz in for the day. And it was at that screening of Pan's Labyrinth where we were backstage about to introduce the film. Guillermo and Ivana Baquero, our young actress lead, Guillermo Navarro, the director of photography, and myself. So the four of us were backstage about to go on to introduce the film, and we had a quiet moment, and that's when Guillermo said to me, he came up and put his arm around me, and he said, "How have you been doing on the Silver Surfer?" So I told him that, you know, the perils and trials of doing that film, and he says, "Well, don't worry about anything. We're gonna have a lot of fun on Hellboy 2." So that's when he told me that he had three roles in mind for me. That was news to me. I said, "Well, wait. So Abe Sapien, I'm reprising, and then what are the other two?" He goes, "Well, I won't tell you right now, but one of them I wrote specifically for you, and the other one I just couldn't figure out who else I'd get." So okay, so. The one was the Angel of Death character, and the one he couldn't figure out who else to get was the Chamberlain, which was kind of a one scene character that that welcomed Prince Nuada home, the elf prince, to the underworld kingdom. I was the sort of the chamber doorkeeper to the throne room of his father, the elven king, and so it was a very boxy headed, long fingered. Character. "Oh, welcome home, sire. Your father is waiting for you." That was it. So, that's, and then I finally got a script for the movie after I got home from the Silver Surfer movie, so I could read and see that Abe Sapien was throughout the entire story in a huge role. And then I was playing the Angel of Death in a very notable sequence in the film, and then the Chamberlain. So I had very, very few days off, I'm going to tell you. Hellboy 2 almost killed me.
So we're running almost at the limit of the time that we told you. We have three questions left. I hope we can
I'll talk less. Go.
Okay. So the first one, Hellboy 2 was one of my favorite comic book movies ever done. And, you know, of course, we know it ends because of your Angel of Death character. We know that there's a third part that at least should happen. Mm-hmm. Do you feel that the Dark Knight, opening a week before the Dark Knight, hurt your chances for having a third one? Or do you... What are the chances that we'll ever see the end of the conclusion, at least that the promised Hellboy story that we got in Hellboy 2?
I'm told not to hold our breath on a part three. It does deserve a part three, and it was set up for that. Yes, I think opening weekend being we dominated the box office for our first week of Hellboy 2. Dark Knight opened the week after, and any comic book movie dollars were spent on that. So. Worldwide, you know, by the end, Hellboy 2 did, I think, you know, like, I think it gathered 85, it fell short of 100 million. So, but it was okay, but not enough to demand a part three. The budget that Guillermo wants for a part three would be, he said, is about $150 million of budget, and he doesn't want to cut corners like he had to the first couple times. And so it's been a standoff between studios not wanting to give that much money and Guillermo demanding it, which he rightfully can now. He's got a reputation and a resume that warrants that kind of budget. That's just fine. So I'm not in with all that's on his plate for the future. We may not see a Hellboy 3, you know, in my lifetime, because Ron Perlman and I, we're getting older, and you know, I can't imagine. He's 64, I'm 54. So that those are some old superheroes.
Sad. So two fan questions. First one is, recently Guillermo del Toro's biggest film was Pacific Rim. Did you ever try to like hint or poke him to say, I want to be in Pacific Rim, find me a part?
No.
Do you?
No, I
have no desire at all.
I have always have a desire, but never poke and prod and never suggest and never flip my hair and say, oh, Guillermo, I never do that. Because he knows who's in his stable of players and he knows what's right for what movie. He's been quoted as saying, if I do a hemorrhoid commercial, Doug Jones would be in it. So that was his way of saying that he'll have me in everything. But in Pacific Rim, his creatures were all completely computer generated. So and he doesn't think of me as a human. There would have been a couple of human roles in Pacific Rim I would have loved to play. But he really thinks of me under rubber bits. And he told me that I effed myself. Bless his heart. He said that he thinks I'm good at that. Therefore, that's what he thinks of me as. So he doesn't consider me for human roles. Maybe I can get that to change one day. I don't know. But in the meantime, he just had me play. I just did a couple of characters in his haunted house story called Crimson Peak. Crimson Peak comes out in theaters in October of 2015, and I played a couple of characters in it. I can't tell you what exactly, but you can guess what a haunted house story might include with Doug Jones. So that's coming. And I also did another character I can't tell you about, but you might, heavy makeup is involved, and it's a vampire show called The Strain, starting on FX in July. And he had me as do a cameo guest role in the season finale, which will be airing sometime in September. That will lead you to believe you might see more of me in season 2 of The Strain. So there's that.
So last question from a fan. Since this actually comes directly to that question, have you had any bad or painful or dangerous experiences involving makeup or prosthetic work?
Oh, nothing dangerous. I'm taken such great care of by all my makeup artists. They're not just great artists. They're also, they're also like nurses, really, because they have to tend to so many needs of an actor that's in a makeup like that. You can't. I feel like a nursing home patient. I can't walk as well. I can't see. Can't hear. My sense of touch is dulled down. So they stay with me all day and they take very, very good care of me. So there's no danger. But if anything, it's just you have to physically push through an awful lot of demanding, bits that day. Whenever you're in a makeup or a costume like that.
Okay, so we're at the time limit that we promised. Is there anything else you'd like to promote, your website or any future appearances, you know, beyond FantasyCon that you'd like to promote to the listeners at this time?
Well, I, absolutely. You'll want to stay tuned to the TNT network Sunday nights at 10 o'clock p.m. all summer long is season 4 of Falling Skies. I'm returning. I started last year with the show. Falling Skies had me join the cast for season 3 as Cochise, the kind and gentle alien warrior of the Volm race that comes to Earth to help the humans fight off the bad aliens who have taken over Earth. It's a post-apocalyptic series that that takes place after an alien invasion, and I'm a good race of alien that has come to help the humans fight off the bad aliens. Because of the history I have with the bad aliens, so my character Cochise will be coming back as strong as ever in season 4, which starts June 22nd, Sunday night, just a couple weeks from now, June 22nd into September, all summer long on TNT Sunday nights at 10.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for this. You've given us a chunk of your time, and we know you're tired and exhausted. This has been fantastic. Thank you so much.
Well, the pleasure has been mine. Thanks so much for having me, Jeremiah.
Thank you. And we'll send this. Do you want us to send it to you before we put it up so you can approve? Or
no need. You can just send a copy of whatever linkage to Publicist Jess. That'd be great.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your time, sir, and best of luck with you. Hopefully I'll see you at FantasyCon.
Oh, also, I forgot to, you mentioned where can people find me. I do have an official website, which is thedougjonesexperience.com. It's been dormant for a minute, so it needs some updating. So my appearances on there are not quite current, but hopefully they will be by the time this airs. My social media, you can find me on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Tumblr, and now Instagram. If you type in Actor Doug Jones as a search word in any of those, you'll find me.
Awesome. Thank you so much, and we'll send as many people your way as possible. This episode, just so you know, should go up on the 21st.
Fantastic. Right before Falling Skies debuts for the season. Great.
That's good timing.
Awesome. Oh, yeah.
Thank you so much, and I look forward to hopefully someday seeing Hellboy 3 with you.
Aw, let's hope. You and me both. Okay.
It would be awesome. Thank you, and have a great day, and get some rest.
You too. Bye-bye.